and that you'd help us to have a real attentive mind and receptive heart to be able to receive from you, know your word more, and be able to apply it to our life and obey what your word has to say. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 John is where we are tonight. So again, we're in the general letters, and we are beginning the letters from John. John, like Peter, was one of the original 12 disciples of Jesus. And John, again, like Peter, was one of the inner three, Peter, James, and John. James and John being brothers, the sons of Zebedee. John wrote the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and also the book of Revelation. So he wrote 5 books in the New Testament. He's referred to in the Gospel of John as the disciple whom Jesus loved 5 times. And so, I mean, he is the author of the Gospel of John, but he's referred to as the disciple whom Jesus loved in that work. He's one of the pillars of the early church, as Paul refers to him in Galatians chapter 2. Church tradition is that he went to Ephesus, Asia Minor, present-day Turkey, in his later years. If you remember, when Jesus was on the cross, he entrusted his mother to the disciple whom he loved, believed to be John, and believed that John took care of Jesus' mother. And he was the only one that was not martyred for his faith of the 12 disciples. I think it's Fox's Book of Martyrs speaks of John being boiled in oil, but miraculously surviving that, then subsequently being banished to the island of Patmos, from where he wrote the Book of Revelation. And so that's just a little bit of church history on the Apostle John. The purpose of the letter, let's look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 4. Where it says, "In these things we write to you, that your joy may be full." And so he's speaking about the fellowship that believers can have with God, so that your joy would be full. So one of the purposes of the letter. Look at chapter 2, verse 1. "My little children, these things I write to you, so that you may not sin." And so the encouragement to not habitually sin. He makes it clear that we are going to sin as Christians, but we won't live in habitual sin. And then, of course, he makes it clear, too, that we can be forgiven as we confess our sins to the Lord. And then look at the last chapter, 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, as we're looking at the purpose of the letter. 1 John 5:13. "These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life." And so the assurance of their salvation through faith in the Son of God, through the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we look at 1 John, we see him encouraging the believers. It's obviously a letter that's written to Christians, encouraging them, warning them from the false teaching and false doctrine that was creeping into the early church. We see cults in our day today. We see various heresies, doctrinal heresies that seem to creep in and out of the church. And we look back into the days of the apostles, and it was already taking place way back then. In the apostles' days, in the second century, the early church fathers dealing with heresies. One of the reasons for the church councils was to get it together and say, this is what we believe concerning the deity of Christ, concerning the nature of God, because of the various heresies that were swirling around the church. And so he addresses those, and we'll see those woven into the fabric of 1 John as he's writing through some of the statements he makes. You can tell he's saying them to combat the heresies that are creeping in to the church at that time. He's rich in metaphors as he speaks about light and darkness and stuff that we understand having read our Bibles and being in church circles, that sometimes we'll refer to as Christianese, an outsider coming in and not really understanding what you're talking about, but the metaphors that are being used that we see, he's rich in those. And he speaks a lot about obedience to the word, and that's seen through the love that comes out of our lives. So you think of the Apostle John, you think of love. You think of one who encouraged the followers of Jesus to love one another. So it's a short book. Let's go ahead and read through it. I'll make some comments as we go through. So 1 John chapter 1, verse 1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life, the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. Now he's referring to Jesus right here. He's referring to that which was from the beginning. We think of John's gospel. In the beginning was the Word, referring to Jesus. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. And so going all the way back before creation, and you have God, and you have the fellowship of the Father and the Son. And so he takes it all the way back to that. And basically what he's saying is we were with him. We heard him. We saw him. And as he said, our hands have handled him. And I don't know about you, but when I read through this, it's lofty language. I have to kind of get my mind into it and really, really look into it with an intentional gaze to really see where he's going because of the way he speaks. But one of the things that I think he's getting at right out of the gate here is that Jesus, who, again, is from the beginning, he is God, he is eternal. As John said, we not only heard him and saw him, but we handled him. Our hands actually touched him, that he was actually a real man too. And this is part of the doctrine of who Jesus is. He is fully God, and he is also fully human. He is God incarnate or manifested in a human body. Again, we go to the heresies that were swirling in the early church, and this is one of them. Some of them see this as the seedlings or an early form of Gnosticism, which again attacked who Jesus was. The concept with Gnosticism was that spirit is good, but matter is evil. So for the Son of God to be a human being and have a material body, well, that can't be because matter is evil. So they would look at him as some, or they believed that he was some sort of phantom. That's what the Gnostics believed. And so, I think as we're reading through this, why did John say something like, we've heard him, we've seen him, we've handled him? Maybe to say as an eyewitness, no, he really is human. We were with him in the beginning. So just a little bit of background as we're making our way through this. But the point being is we were with him and we had fellowship with him. And this is talking about the relationship that we can have with God. Verse 3, that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you that your joy may be full. And your joy will be full if you have fellowship with the Father and the Son, if you're in relationship with God. Verse 5, this is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Here come the metaphors. He's light. And when we think of light, as far as how he means it, we think of that which is good. We think of darkness. Think of that which is bad or that which is evil. And so in speaking of God, speaks of him as light, pure goodness, as opposed to evil. And then he says in verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. So again, look at the metaphors here. If we say that we have fellowship with him, if we're in relationship with him, and yet we walk. Now again, we're used to this kind of terminology in Christian circles, but the idea of walking is how we live our life. If we live our life in darkness, darkness again representing evil, if we live our life in evil and doing evil things, and yet we say that we are having fellowship with God, then we're lying. Because you can't be living a life of doing evil things and have fellowship with God. And so this is one of those things where you look at the fruit of a person's life. Depending on how they're living, you can kind of tell where they're at with God, and that's what he's bringing out here. Verse 7, contrasting that, but if we walk in the light, if we regulate our life according to that which is good and godly, according to the word of God, if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. And underline the word all, because it cleanses us from all sin. From the original sin that we inherited from Adam, from our past sins that we committed, to our present sins that go on in our minds, to the future sins that unfortunately will come, the blood of Jesus. And what does that mean, the blood of Jesus? It means his death upon the cross. His death upon the cross provides atonement, forgiveness for our sin. Verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Interesting thing about verse 8, the word sin is singular there. It's not saying if we say that we have no sins, plural, but that if we have no sin, singular. And scholars point out that this seems to be referring to the inherited fallen nature from Adam. If we say that we have no sin nature, that we didn't inherit a fallen nature from Adam, then we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us, because the reality is we have. I mean, we are sinners because we are descendants of Adam, not because we commit sin. Okay? If we confess our sins, and here's the good news. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The word confess means to say the same thing. So it means to agree with God. What he calls sin is actually sin. God, I'm agreeing with you that the thing that I just did is wrong in your sight. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say, verse 10, that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. And so you can see the idea here that we are sinners that are forgiven as we confess our sins and come to God through Jesus. Have you guys ever heard of the idea of sinless perfection? In other words, you become a Christian and God's Spirit dwells within you, and now you can live. You have the potential to live a perfect, sinless life. That's referred to as the doctrine of sinless perfection, that you can attain to that and that God really expects you to strive for that and to attain it. The people that I've known, and thankfully it hasn't been that many, the people that I've known that have believed in sinless perfection, none of them are walking with the Lord right now. And I think the reason why is because they became overwhelmed when they failed, because you can't live a sinless life this side of eternity. God doesn't want us to live in habitual sin, but there's no way we're going to be perfect this side of eternity. And I think the reason why is this. I think it's because we've been delivered from the power of sin, but not the presence of sin. We still live in these corrupted bodies. Okay, and so we're not going to be delivered from that until we're clothed in the new model. So delivered from the power of sin, we have the Holy Spirit residing within, giving us the ability to be able to stand up and yield to his Spirit and do the right thing. But there's still the presence of sin that's here within our fallen nature, in this corrupt mortal body that we're still within, that we're still in. And so even though we're not going to be sinless, God expects us to sin less. You get it? So again, we shouldn't live in habitual sin, which he's going to talk about in just a little bit. So, okay, deep breath. Chapter 2, my little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. We have an advocate. It's like he is our defense attorney. We're guilty and we're there before the judge, and he's the one that stands up to represent us. We have an advocate with the Father. The word advocate is the Greek word parakletos, and it's the word that's translated as the comforter or the helper in the Gospel of John, referring to the Holy Spirit. It's kind of neat, isn't it? The one who's called alongside to help, and we have one who is called alongside to help us, Jesus Christ the righteous, who is our advocate, because as Revelation chapter 12 verse 10 tells us, we have an accuser of the brethren who is accusing us before God day and night, and that is Satan. And some of us give him a lot of things, a lot of material to accuse us of. And so Jesus is there to stand and say, I have died for their sin. Verse 2 says, and he himself is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the whole world. Some of the translations, I think, have the atoning sacrifice. And the idea is he is the one who has died for us. That's why he's our advocate. That's why he's the one who can stand up for us. He's the one who has died in our place. But the word propitiation, it means the idea of a substitutionary sacrifice that satisfies the justice of God. That's the depth of the meaning of propitiation. It has satisfied God's justice because God is a just God. He's a loving God, but he's also just. And so when forgiveness comes, Jesus is the one who is satisfied. Okay, there was a sin committed and a payment needs to be made, and Jesus made that payment. Debt has been met. Paid in full, debt canceled. And so the propitiation, the one who satisfies God's justice for our sins, and notice, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. So he died. The idea is he died so that everyone could come to God and be saved. Yet in reality, that forgiveness is really only attributed to the person who comes through faith in Christ so that we can be forgiven. Verse 3, now by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Now he's getting into the doing part. What does Christianity look like? It's obedience. It's doing what God has called us to do. Verse 4, he who says, I know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. So that's kind of similar to what it said in chapter 1. If you say you have fellowship with him, but you walk in darkness, well, you're a liar. And right here, if you say you know God and you don't keep his commandments, well, you're a liar. You don't. Again, the test is seen in the way we live, in what comes out of our life. And so keeping his commandments. Verse 5, but whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked, conduct their lives the way God wants us to. Verse 7, brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment, which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. No new commandment, an old commandment. Again, a new commandment. You see what I mean by following John? Sometimes you have to be really intentional as you're reading it. What is the old commandment? What is the new commandment? It's really no new commandment at all. The idea, what it comes down to, the Apostle John, is love. You go into the Old Testament again, as Jesus summed it up. What is it? It's loving God supreme. It's loving your neighbor as yourself. But when you come into the new commandment, you see love in such a deeper way, where Jesus lays his life down and he calls on his disciples in John chapter 13 to have that same kind of sacrificial love. And so that's the idea. Now, why would he word it like that? Why would he word it like, I'm not giving you a new commandment, it's an old commandment, but then say a new commandment? In antiquity, and this is from the IVP, Bible Background Commentary, in antiquity, paradox was one graphic way of forcing an audience to think through the meaning of one's words. John uses it here, old, not new, but new. The love commandment was old, always part of God's word, Deuteronomy 6:5, Leviticus 19:18. That's the one where you love God with all your heart and soul, and where you love your neighbor as yourself. And it was cited by Jesus in Mark chapter 12, but also new, based on a new and ultimate example, again, Jesus in John chapter 13, where he gave his disciples that new commandment to love one another as he had loved them. Verse 9, he who says he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. Again, we're looking at love, we're looking at obedience to God's word, and we're seeing it worked out in the person's life. So he who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in darkness until now. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you have known the Father. I have written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you and you have overcome the wicked one. Maybe referring to different levels of maturity in their Christian walk as he writes and encourages them in their Christian walk. Now the warning, verse 15, do not love the world or the things in the world. Again, in Christian circles, we understand what he means by that, don't we? But imagine if you are sitting in church and this is your first time in church and you read something like this, do not love the world. Well, what does that mean? Does that mean the planet? Does that mean the people that are in the world do not love the world? What exactly does it mean? It's referring to the standards that this world operates under. We would kind of refer to it maybe as things that are politically correct. And that changes, doesn't it, as time goes on? It's a lot different today than it was 30 or 40 years ago. I mean, there are things that are accepted today that were completely forbidden 30 or 40 years ago. But that changes, doesn't it? It's the standards of this present system that we live in. Well, as those change, as it's shown in our country, they get further and further away from what we read in the Bible. And so oftentimes what we see in this present world is in stark contrast to what we read in the Bible and what God's desire is for his creation. And so as he speaks about this, about the world, he's talking about this present system that is actually under the grip or in the grip of the devil himself. It's a pretty powerful statement, isn't it? But this is the book. Let's turn to the last chapter. This is the book that speaks about that. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 19, almost the last verse of the book, it says, we know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. 1 John 5, 19, we know we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway or the influence or the control of the wicked one. And so Satan is influencing the world that we live in. And so the standards that our world operates under are heavily influenced by Satan. And so you can see why John would say, do not love the world, because this is what Satan is influencing a lot of the standards that we see in here. So do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Verse 16, for all that is in the world, and now he defines it, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. I oftentimes will pull this up in the Living Bible. This isn't the New Living Translation, but this is the Living Bible, a paraphrase on this verse right here in 1 John 2:16. It says, for all these worldly things, these evil desires, the craze for sex, the lust of the flesh, the ambition to buy everything that appeals to you, the lust of the eyes, and the pride that comes from wealth and importance, the pride of life, these are not from God. They are from this evil world itself. Doesn't that seem to define where we are today? Then it seemed to just be that. And so what is he saying? Don't love those things, because if you do, the love of the Father is not in you. It's in direct opposition to what we read about within the Word of God. Verse 17, and the world is passing away and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. The world is passing away. Last week, 2 Peter chapter 3, it's all going to burn anyway. This present system is all going to be burned up. So we want to be walking uprightly with God and not buying into, again, as John puts it, the things in this world. Verse 18, little children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now, many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. Now, the word Antichrist, and we use that quite often, don't we? As we're speaking about end times. John is the only one who uses that term, the Antichrist. We read about this Antichrist that is coming in many different books of the Bible, but we read about him with different names, the little horn in the book of Daniel, or the man of sin, or the son of perdition in the book of 2 Thessalonians, or the beast of Revelation chapter 13. But it's here that we get the word Antichrist in John's writings. And the idea is one who opposes Christ, Antichrist, and implying the usurping of Christ and his position. So one who opposes Jesus, but also in place of, if you will. And I think what John is referring to here is he makes the statement, you have heard that the Antichrist is coming. But then he says, even now, many Antichrists have come. Many Antichrists, well, one who opposes Christ, one who is in the place of Christ, false prophets, false teachers, I think is what he's speaking of here. And again, there are various heresies that are creeping into the church. And I think this is what he's bringing up. He says, yes, there's one coming, but many are here with us right now that are opposing the true teachings of Jesus. Verse 19, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. It almost sounds like they came out from the fellowship. It almost sounds like they came out from within the church and came up with this heretical doctrine and went out and started doing their own thing. Verse 20, but you have an anointing from the Holy One and you know all things. Now, heretical teachings coming within the church, but you, and this is the encouragement here, you have an anointing from the Holy One and you know all things. And the idea is you have the Holy Spirit residing within that's going to bear witness to you what the truth is and what error is based upon the Word of God. And that's the great thing about it, is it keeps us safe and not under the mercies of the false teachers, where somebody just teaches me that. No, that's what they said. I must believe it. No, I've got discernment. Why? Because the Holy Spirit resides within. And he's bearing witness to the truth of the Word of God and pointing out what error is. You have an anointing from the Holy One. And you know all things. Verse 21, I have not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar? But he who denies that Jesus is the Christ or the Messiah, the anointed of God, he is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. And so I think in here a reference to the deity of Jesus, as it speaks of the Father and the Son in this way. Therefore, verse 24, let that abide in you, which you heard from the beginning. If what you heard from the beginning abides in you, you also will abide in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he has promised us, eternal life. These things I've written to you concerning those who try to deceive you. Verse 27, but the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you. Isn't that neat right there? And again, I think when he speaks again, in verse 27, the anointing which you have received from him abides in you. I think he's speaking of the Holy Spirit that abides within. And so you don't need anyone to teach you. Again, you don't have to be bound to the teachings of the heresies that come through. But as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things and is true and is not a lie, and just as it has taught you, you will abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Abide in Christ so that when he comes and you stand before him, you won't be ashamed, but you'll have confidence. You'll be able to stand there. Verse 29, if you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of him. John 16, 13. Speaking of the anointing that resides within, Jesus said, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth and he will tell you things to come, referring to the Holy Spirit. John 14, 26, Jesus said, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. And I think the initial idea here was for the disciples. The initial idea is that the Holy Spirit would teach the disciples and bring to remembrance everything that Jesus said so that they could pen the scriptures, they could pen the Gospels, Matthew and John, and write down, bring back to remembrance to memory what Jesus had said. But I also think this applies to believers too, that he would lead us into all truth, that he would teach us and bear witness in our hearts as to what the truth is. Okay? Deep breath. Chapter 3. I know this is a crazy way to go through a Wednesday night Bible study, but I hate to just skim over verses. So let's just read and I'll try and keep the comments brief. Chapter 3, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. I don't know what it's going to be like, but the cool thing about it is we're going to be like him. It says in 1 Corinthians 15:51 and 52, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. This mortal, this corruption is going to put on immortality and incorruption. Philippians 3:20 and 21, our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body or our humble body that it may be conformed to his glorious body. We don't know what we're going to be like, but we know we're going to be like him. It's pretty awesome, isn't it? Verse 3, and everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. And I think the idea is we have a hope of a better tomorrow. And so it's that motivator that drives us to, hey, I want to live uprightly before the Lord. I don't want to be ashamed when he comes, but I want to be able to stand there with confidence because I know what kind of future I have in front of me. Verse 4, whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Verse 6, whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. Now this is where we get the big uh-oh, because we do sin, don't we? But this seems to be saying, if we do sin, that we haven't known him. Let's read on, then we'll come back. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, because he has been born of God. Now, some of you that have different translations, some of the newer translations, the NIV or the NAS, it already pointed it out to you. But in the New King James here, and in the King James, it's not bringing out the tense. The tense in verse 6, especially, is what's called the continuous present tense. And the idea is no one who continually abides in him makes a habit of sinning. And no one who habitually sins has seen or know him. Do you see the difference there? The idea isn't an occasional sin. Oops, I got upset and mad when this guy cut me off on the road. But the person who is habitually sinning, living in a lifestyle of sin, whatever it might be, whether it might be immorality, whether it might be criticalness or lying, deception, just a lifestyle. This is what defines me. This is who I am. I'm living in opposition to God's word. That's habitual sin that he points out here and makes it very clear that if that's you, then you've never known him. So that's kind of an eye-opener when you have somebody who is living in habitual sin. You know, one of the key things to point out, my concern really, is that a person's life is not right with God if they're living in habitual sin. And it's making some very direct statements that you've never really known him. Oh yeah, but I confess him. Well, your actions are speaking contrary to that. And so this is kind of a key indicator, again, brought out in the tense of the Greek that a lot of the newer translations bring out in that. The idea is continuous, habitual sin. If you're in that state, you haven't known him. You're not living uprightly before the Lord, and that should arrest our attention. In verse 10, we continue on. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God. Righteousness is not of God. Nor is he who does not love his brother. Now, he's going to come in and out of this, the obedience of living the Christian life and pictures of what that looks like. And again, bringing love in here. Love is opposed to hate. Verse 11, for this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another, not as Cain, from Cain and Abel, who was of the wicked one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his works were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not marvel, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. And again, the idea is this is the fruit being manifest out of the believer's life. So if you're like Cain and have a murderous heart, then your life isn't right with God. Okay, that's a good indicator that you're not on the right path. Whoever hates his brother, verse 15, is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? Again, you see how it's practically worked out. Do I really love my brother who's really in need? Do I shut up my heart? Oh, sorry. It's like what James said, faith without works is dead. You can say you have faith, but if there's no actions that come behind it, then it's a dead faith. It's just meaningless words. My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Verse 19, and by this we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence toward God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Now, this isn't one of those blanket things. Whatever I ask, I'm going to get from God. Notice the qualification that's in here. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing. I think it's showing that you're in the center of God's will. You're doing what he wants you to do. I think the implication is, if we're in the center of his will, we're going to be asking according to his will. And of course, that's what he wants to do, is have his will accomplished. So I think that's the idea there in the understanding. And this is his commandment, verse 23, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. Now he who keeps his commandments abides in him, and he in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us. Deep breath. Chapter 4. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. So it's about using discernment. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. What's the issue here? That Jesus has come in the flesh. What does that mean? That he was a human being. Again, we come back to the setting of his day. Some were saying, no, he matter's evil. He couldn't have had a human body. He was just a phantom. And John, I think, is combating that right now and say, no, he came in a human body. And so the ones that are saying he did not, then they are false teachers or antichrist. Verse 4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Don't you love that verse right there? The one that is in them is of the enemy, but the one that is in you is God's Holy Spirit, and he is much greater. Verse 5, they are of the world, therefore they speak as of the world, and the world hears them. Verse 6, we are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And here comes the emphasis on love. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, for God so loved the world. Verse 10, in this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be, here it is again, the propitiation for our sins. Here's the issue. Not that we're these great creatures and we love God, but it's that he loved us. He loved us first. And he sent his Son into the world when we were still enemies of his. He sent his Son into the world to die for our sins. So this is true love here. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son. Again, the word propitiation, the idea is the substitute. He died in my place. And again, the idea is that it satisfies the justice of God. The payment has been made. The debt has been canceled. Verse 11, beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Again, how does this seem out in my life? Verse 12, no one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. Because he has given us of his Spirit. Think about what we've been talking about here, what John's been talking about. The evidence of the Christian life, the things that we do, our obedience to his commandments. And one of the main things he's been talking about is love. It's the Spirit of God that produces that fruit in our life. If we love like God loves, it's not us trying really hard, it's the Holy Spirit residing within. The fruit of the Spirit is love. And so here's an evidence. Evidence that you're a child of God is your life has changed. You're not the same person that you used to be. And one of those key elements that we see is love coming through our lives. By this we know, again, that we abide in him, verse 13, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Verse 15, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God and God in him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. That we might have boldness in the day of judgment, boldness that we might have confidence. The day of judgment for the believer is not the great white throne judgment of God. It's not the judgment of the nations. It's the bema seat of Christ. It's standing before him, giving an account of what we've done while we've been down here on earth. And what is it going to be? Are we going to be able to stand there with confidence because we were like Christ in this world? In other words, we allowed his Holy Spirit to work in our lives and to work through our lives. Chapter 4, verse 17 in the New Living Translation, and as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face him with confidence because we are like Christ here in this world. We are in this world, but we're not of this world. We want to be here like him, showing his love to the rest of the world. Verse 18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because fear involves torment, but he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? See how John is continually bringing it back to the actions and calling people on the carpet. You can say you love God, but if you hate your brother, you're a liar. So it's the fruit that's coming out of your life, the actions. And this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother also. Last deep breath, we move into chapter 5. Not too bad, huh? Not too bad. You know what I like about going through it this way? I mean, we don't typically do this kind of a Bible study, but what I like about it is you're getting kind of the overview of it, and you're still reading every verse. And so you can kind of walk away from 1 John and go, oh yeah, I get the idea of what he was saying there. Admittedly, 1 John, the language in it, for me, it's challenging. where he's the way he puts the words together and is talking with it, really got to focus in on the topic at hand and what he is talking about. Here in chapter 5, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. And everyone who loves him who begot the Father also loves him who is begotten of him, the Son. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Remember, Jesus said of his yoke that it was easy and his burden is light. What he has for us to do isn't a burden. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Speaking of Jesus, the Son of God, verse 6, this is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not only by water, but by water and blood. What does that mean? He came by water and by blood. Water, baptism is the common interpretation of that. Baptism, the beginning of his ministry, when the Spirit of God came down like a dove, alighted upon him, remained upon him, empowered him for the ministry that he had. The Father spoke from heaven, water and blood, obviously speaking of his shed blood, speaking of the culmination of that ministry, the death on the cross for our sin. That's the common interpretation of that, that he came and completed a mission. He began that mission, the water, the baptism, starting out in that ministry, and then he saw it through to the end where he died upon the cross for the sins of the world. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is the truth. So the Holy Spirit bearing witness, testifying of the truth of Jesus. Let's think about that for just a moment. In John 15, 26, Jesus said, but when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. He will testify of me. He will bear witness as to who I am and what I've done. He will bear witness to the truth. Jesus said in the Gospel of John that the Spirit would be in the world, convicting the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. That he would be the one testifying and drawing people and bringing that conviction into people's lives. I think that's what draws us. I think he's the one who draws us to salvation by working in our hearts. That's why we pray when we're having a service or doing an outreach, that God would go before and prepare the hearts of the people. And we really mean that, that he would be working throughout circumstances in their lives to get their heart in a spot where they're open and they're ready to hear the gospel and have that word of hope come in. And so here Jesus came on a mission, came by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. And then verse 7, for there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. Now, depending on the translation you have, verse 7 might look a little bit different. If you're reading New King James or the King James, or you might even look in your margin to see if there's something written in your margin about verse 7. When you look at verse 7, there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, which would refer to Jesus, the Son. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh. You have the Father, the Word, or the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. That's a powerful verse for the triune nature of God, isn't it? I mean, that's a powerful verse as a key text for the Trinity. And yet none of the early church fathers used this verse when they were having their early councils on defining the nature of God. And describing the nature of God and the triune nature of God was one of the key elements of those early church councils. So why wouldn't they use one of the most obvious verses in the Bible to be able to do that? And that comes down to the issue of this verse. Is this verse meant to be in the Bible, or was it added by a copyist? How many times have you heard me actually say this? Does this verse really belong in the Bible? If you've been around any time at all, you know that I'm one that says this is God's word. He has given it to us. This is what we live by. This is how we practice our faith, is by the word that we have right here. And there's an abundance of manuscript evidence that we can put our trust in the Bible. And I firmly believe that. But with the abundance of manuscript evidence, and we've talked about 6,000 plus Greek manuscripts, you find this verse in three of those manuscripts. Okay? Of the thousands that we have, it's in three manuscripts. Why is it in the King James and the New King James Bible is a story that if you'd still like to listen, I will read to you at the end of the Bible study. But this would be one of those verses where I would lean to the side of those ones who would say, you know, this probably was a marginal note in one of the scriptures that was included in the text as it was being copied down because of that. And this is the confidence, rather than this shaking our confidence as, well, what do you mean this verse shouldn't be in here? It really should strengthen our faith in it, because we have so many manuscripts, it makes a verse stick out like a sore thumb if it's only in one or two manuscripts. And there's a story behind why it came into the King James Version of the Bible, okay? Is the doctrine of the Trinity, the triune nature of God, in the Bible? Absolutely. Father, Son, Holy, I mean, you see it throughout the Bible, not just the New Testament either. I mean, you see the plurality in the Godhead within the Old Testament as well. It's not like it's this verse and this alone that defines it. So it doesn't take away from the truth of the doctrine at all. It just addresses the issue of this one particular verse within the King James and the New King James Version of the Bible. And as some have, again, put it in the marginal note, and I want to explain why, but not right now. I want to make our way through this, and then we'll come back to that. The whole idea is this. Jesus came to bring a sacrifice for our sin. And he came in this mission, if this is the correct interpretation, by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that testifies. It is the water, the baptism, it is the blood, his death upon the cross, and the Holy Spirit who is in the world convicting the world of the truth of who Jesus is, and that there is a day of reckoning that's coming. That's the whole idea within this passage right here, okay? So having said that, the way it would read if verse 7 wasn't in there, it would be the end of verse 6, and it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth, for there are three that bear witness. Verse 8, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one. That's how the majority of manuscripts read through 1 John chapter 5. That makes sense? Okay, and we'll talk about it more at the end. Verse 9, if we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God which he has testified of his Son. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son. And this is the testimony, verse 11, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. There's only one way. God has given us eternal life, and it is through his Son, through faith in Jesus. Verse 13, these things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. So the purpose of the letter, one of the key purposes, is the assurance of your faith. Brand new Christian, I don't know if it was Navigators Bible study or what I was going through, but these are the first two verses that I ever memorized in the Bible, was verse 12 and 13. He who has the Son has life, and he who does not have the Son of God does not have life. These things I've written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Now, this is the confidence that we have in him. that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. Again, at first it sounds like a blanket promise. Whatever we ask, he hears. We know we're going to get it. But notice it's according to his will. It's not asking amiss, like James puts it, that we might spend it on our own lust, but asking according to his will. And of course, he wants to accomplish his will in our lives, through our lives. Verse 16, if anyone sees his brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, he will ask and he will give him life for those who commit sin not leading to death. There is sin leading to death. I do not say that he should pray about that. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is sin not leading to death. Now, what does that mean? Again, this is one of those verses where you're just going, what is it? What sin is he talking about? Sin that leads to death, the sin that does not lead to death? You know, some have said, is this the unpardonable sin? Is he talking about that? You know, well, what is the unpardonable sin? Again, I think it's simply rejecting Jesus, you know, rejecting the wooing, the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And you know, I don't know if that, but I'll tell you this. It was this morning that I'm reading through in my morning devotions, and I'm in Deuteronomy. And this verse, and I really kind of, I actually was enjoying the passage. It's just those laws that come up. You know, if you do this, this is the punishment for it. And it was just kind of on a roll and kind of just bearing witness. But it was at that passage of scripture where it was talking about being pure. And if a man commits adultery with his neighbor's wife, then, you know, he should be killed and the wife should be killed. And then if a man violates a woman and they're in the city limits, then he should be stoned to death and she should be stoned to death. But if they're out in the country, then he should be killed, but she shouldn't be killed because they're out in the country and she could have screamed and nobody was there to help her. And it's, you know, it's just these laws that are there for the nation of Israel, and also showing what God likes and what he doesn't like, how he wants us to live. But there was a phrase in Deuteronomy 22:26 when it's speaking about this girl that was taken advantage of, that was in the country, and it says, do nothing to the girl. There is no sin in the girl worthy of death. And I thought about that for a moment as I was thinking about this, and I thought, you know, maybe it ties into a sin leading to death. Maybe, and I really don't know. Maybe it ties in to the consequences that come in this life. Maybe it's just talking about physical death, the consequences that come, the things that we do, a sin that would lead to death. I go out and I kill people. Well, can I be forgiven? Yeah. Am I gonna face the consequences? Yeah, what is that gonna be? Well, it's probably gonna be my life being taken from me. And I don't know, I just throw that out there because it came into my mind. It's one of those passages that I don't fully got a grasp on. This is exactly what he means by that. Verse 18, we know that whoever is born of God does not sin, but he who has been born of God keeps himself, and the wicked one does not touch him. Again, I want to point out to you that is in the newer translations. We know that whoever is born of God does not continually sin, does not habitually sin. And that's the tense there. Verse 19, we know that we are of God and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. And this is good to remember. It's good to remember the influence that the devil has in our world system, that he is the god of this world, that he is affecting people. And that's why there is a spiritual war and there is a challenge in living the Christian life. Verse 20, and we know that the Son of God has come and has given us an understanding that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. Amen. All right, that concludes. Do you guys want to hear about 1 John 5, 7? Sure. The notes I got on it? I have, I think, some great words on it. It's very informative. And it's, if you wanted to look at it online, it's from David Guzik's note, Enduring Word Media. Google David Guzik's commentaries, and he's got all of his commentaries on the internet. But this is the comment on verse 7. A few words on this text regarding the notes in the margins or footnotes of many Bibles regarding 1 John 5, 7, and 8. First of all, do you have a marginal note in your Bible concerning that verse? Okay, you guys have it. And it's this is my marginal note. Even though it's right within the text on mine in the margin, it says concerning verse 7, N-U, which means nestles and ungers, these are our Greek texts, and M, which I believe is the majority text, omit the words from in heaven of verse 7 through on earth of verse 8. So it was squeezed down to how I had mentioned it before. So again, for there are three that bear witness, verse 7, and then it would end, go to the end of the word earth in verse 8, the spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three are one. And then it says only four or five very late manuscripts contain these words in Greek. Is that basically what your marginal note says as well? Something like that? Okay, and so if it's in the text, it puts that in the note, in the margin. I think if you have a newer translation, it's not even in the text, but maybe in the margin, is that correct? That you've got that some manuscripts add this in that passage. So this is the deal with it. The New King James Bible makes a marginal note, 1 John 5, 7, and 8, stating that the words in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one, and there are three that bear witness on earth, are words that are not included in the vast majority of New Testament Greek manuscripts. The words in question occur, and again, this is like FYI, this is for your information, as to why there is a marginal note, why there is an issue, why I would even bring it up, okay, on this particular passage. And this is one of maybe two passages, maybe three passages that I would even bring out in a Bible study out of the whole Bible. And the other two, I don't even know if I would lean towards they probably weren't in there originally, like I would on this one. So this might be the only one, okay? Just after my reading, what I would go, yeah, I think that's probably right. And a lot of it is based on the information that's right here. So the words in question occur in no Greek manuscript until the 14th century, except for one 11th century and one 12th century manuscript in which they have been added to the margin by another hand. In the first few hundred years of Christianity, there were many theological debates regarding the exact nature and understanding of the Trinity, the councils that they would have. And part of it, again, what John is addressing is the heresies that were going on in the church. And so whoever doesn't confess it, Jesus Christ is a human being, that he came in the flesh. So there were councils that were taking place in the early centuries to cover this. In all of those debates, no one ever once quoted these words in question from 1 John 5, 7, and 8. So they never brought it up. If they were originally written by John, it seems very strange that no early Christian would have quoted them. In fact, though none of the ancient Christians quote from this verse, several of them do quote from 1 John 5, 6 and 1 John 5, 8. And that kind of stands out. You know, they're quoting in the passage, they quote on verse 6 and verse 8, but never mention verse 7, the early church fathers. Why skip verse 7? Especially if it is such a great statement of the Trinity. That's a good question, isn't it? In all ancient translations, Syriac, Arabic, Ethiopian, Coptic, Sahidic, Armenian, Slavonian, and so forth, this disputed passage is not included. Only in the Latin Vulgate does it appear. David's comment, it is probably best to regard these words as the work of an overzealous copyist who thought that the New Testament needed a little help with the doctrine of the Trinity, and he figured this was a good place to do it, or perhaps the words just started as notes written in the margin of a manuscript, but the next person who copied the manuscript thought they must belong in the text itself. It's just speculation on how did it get in there. While there is no explicit statement of the Trinity in the statement, such as this. It is woven, as I mentioned earlier, into the fabric of the New Testament. We find the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit working together as equal yet distinct persons. And again, if you want to look, where are the scriptures on the Trinity? David Guzik's notes, it's great. He's got close to a dozen references here in the New Testament. How did these words ever get included if they are not in any ancient Greek manuscript? The words were included in ancient Latin versions of the Bible. And in the year 1520, a great scholar, and here's the story on how did it end up in the King James, a great scholar named Erasmus produced a new, accurate edition of the Bible in ancient Greek. When people studied Erasmus's Bible and compared it to the Latin version, they noticed he left out this passage, and they criticized him for it. When he was criticized, Erasmus said, "You won't find these words in any ancient Greek manuscript. If you find me one Greek manuscript with these words in them, I'll include it in my next printing." Someone, quote, discovered a manuscript with the words in them, but it wasn't an ancient manuscript at all. Erasmus knew this, but had already promised to add the words if someone found a manuscript with the words, so he reluctantly added the words in his 1522 edition. However, he also added a footnote saying he thought that the new Greek manuscript had been written on purpose just to embarrass him. That manuscript, Codex Montforti, is on display in the Library of Trinity College, Dublin. So that's the story that lies behind it. Of the Greek manuscripts that were used to translate the King James Version in 1611, this was one of the manuscripts. And this is how it made its way. Again, of thousands of manuscripts, this is how it made its way into the King James Version of the Bible. And of course, the New King James is basically the King James without the these and the thous. It's not a translation in the sense of bringing other Greek manuscripts into question. And so there's still quite a bit, but I don't think it really mentions much more than this. Do we need that verse to know the doctrine of the triune nature of God in the Bible? You don't. You can see it in a number of other passages. So anyway, one of the last things I like to do with the Bible study is go, that verse isn't supposed to be in the Bible. Let's move on, you know, as we're going on. It's something that, again, this is probably the only spot where I would really make mention of it and then side with it as well. There is one other thing that I thought he really said. When such a passage like this is inserted, the textual evidence from the manuscripts makes it stick out like a sore thumb. This gives us assurance as opposed to doubt. Do you see the logic in that? In other words, we've got so many manuscripts to compare. When you've got one that stands out like this, it really does make it stand out and make you go, well, hey, how come that's only there? And then as you dig and you look at the, not just the story behind Erasmus, but you look at the early church writings. And, you know, just like we read commentaries today by guys who are living in our day, well, they were writing commentaries back then, the early church fathers, and they're commenting on these books. And for them to just skip right past that verse really seems to stand out as evidence in the fact that it wasn't there. So that is my opinion on that verse. It's really hard to go by it and not say anything. So there you have it. Let's pray, shall we? Father, we want to thank you for the time we could spend here. And thank you for the evidence that you have left us of your word, so that we can compare and we can have a confidence of what the truth is. And I thank you that throughout the centuries that the people of God have stood strong upon the truth that you have delivered to the saints and that have been able to stand through many church councils and many heretical teachers that would try and bring error within to the Christian community, and to be able to stand strong according to the truths that they find and that we find in your word, to be able to know what the clear teaching and truth is. And so I just pray that you would continue to build our faith in you through your word as we continue to go through the Bible in Jesus' name. Amen.